record the meeting today just so that we have really accurate notes, because we know we want to share everything that we talk about with all of the project directors who are on right now and all of our faculty members who are definitely going to need this information. And this is our first leadership team meeting for CHAMP. Really just want to start by introducing each other, making who's on the line, talking to, and then the plan for today is to go through what the objectives are for this grant from our statement of work, and for each different objective to hear from all of you what your vision is. And really, this should be interesting because so many of you are on the phone, but truly the point of this meeting is to have you tell me what you expect the colleges to come up with through participation in this grant, and then it's up to several of the folks in the room today to then make your vision happen. So this team is really about kind of the big picture and visioning and setting the tone for what the grant looks like, and so we're excited to have you all. So let's start with the folks in the room. Brenda, will you just introduce yourself and say how you're related to the project?
Brenda Perea, I am the Instructional Design Coordinator for the grant here at the CCCS Admin Building.
And I'm Chris Button. I'm the Dean of the Center for Career and Technical Education at the Community College of Denver, and we are a participant in the grant.
And I'm Marilyn Smith at the System Office, and I'll be working with the navigator.
I'm Mary Cornell. I'm the Administrative
Assistant
for the grant.
And become Critical
Prior
Learning Coordinator.
Grant. I'm Dave Griffin. I'm with the Colorado Rural Workforce Consortium, working with Pueblo and Lamar Community College.
Casey Sachs, Project Manager. And that's who we have in the room. Alita, will you start and talk and introduce yourself?
Yeah. Alita Sherman, I'm a regional director for the Colorado Association for Manufacturing and Technology. We're a Department of Commerce program that supports manufacturers in the state, assists. So we want to be able to support this grant in any way that makes sense. So I really want to get updated and know in what way can we help.
Terrific. Thank you. Sunny? Uh-huh.
Good morning, everybody. I'm Dr. Sunny Smith, and I'm the Chief Academic Officer at Pueblo Community College, and we are also part of the grant.
Gina?
Just out of the room.
Gina and Steve, I unmuted you.
Okay. Gina just walked back in.
Oh, I'm Gina Nance, and I'm the plant manager at DCC. And I am an employer for the electrical mechanical group.
I'm Steve Track from Pueblo Workforce Center.
Gotti?
Yeah, this is Dr. Gotti Changak. I'm from Ames Community College. Thank you.
Bob?
Hey, good morning. Bob Rizzuto, Interim Vice President at Red Rock. And Kelly Serpo is with us as well, giving them some.
Good morning, Bob and Kelly.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Linda?
Good morning, everybody. Linda Curran. I head up the Longmont campus, one of the three campuses for Front Range Community College. And Front Range is the fiscal lead on this project, and we're part of the grant, and the machining program that the grant funds is actually going to open on my campus.
Thank you. Paul?
Yeah, this is Paul Harder. I'm president and CEO for a manufacturing company here in Colorado called Aqua Hot Heating Systems. My principal interest in all of this is to open communication between manufacturers in Colorado and the educators in Colorado so we can develop the workforce that we're going to need in the future.
Thank you. Stephanie and Emily?
Good morning, everyone. This is Emily Templin-Lush with the Colorado Workforce Development Council, and Stephanie Steffens, the director of the council, will be joining shortly, and she will actually be the one sitting on the leadership team. And we work closely to align workforce education and economic development to ensure that the manufacturers have the talent that they need, and also work across other industries.
Great. Thank you.
Thank you.
Tim?
Try that again. Tim Heaton from the Colorado Advanced Manufacturing Alliance. I would echo what Paul said. Our main goal is to make sure that we can get the professional trainers working in concert with the needs of the manufacturers.
Thank you. Tricia?
Hi, this is Tricia Johnson with Emily Griffith Technical College. I'm the Chief Academic Officer here, and we are a training participant in the grant.
Great. Linda just walked in, and I'll have her introduce herself.
Good morning. I'm Linda Murphy. I'm Director of the Colorado Urban Workforce Alliance, and my purpose in being with all of you is to ensure that the local workforce regions develop full partnerships on the grant. Is that what you mean?
Perfect. Thank you. So we know we're waiting for a couple folks, and you can see them on your screen. We've got Stacey Bivick, who's a machining employer, Shannon Lind and Robert Crum, who are both in welding, Joe Wilcox, who's an electromechanical employer. We're still searching for a manufacturer and building trades employer, so if you know somebody we can recruit, please send them my way. Tom with Campy will be joining us in the future, and Alita's here right now with the same group. Carla Tartt is part of our group, Ben Nesbitt, Director of Skilled Trades here at CCCS. And we also know Cindy Buckley from Pikes Peak, Vicki Godlick from Metro, and Cheryl Sanchez from Lamar, kind of round out our team. So thank you, everybody.
Casey, this is John Vukic.
Hi, John.
And just to let everybody know, I'm the project coordinator for the Manufacturing Career Pathway Project.
Thank you for introducing yourself. Do we have any other guests on the phone? Thank you for being here, John. I really appreciate it.
You bet.
So here are the objectives for the CHAMP grant. We know that we want to develop and enhance advanced manufacturing training. We know that we want to make the content available online, that we have a strong emphasis around credit for prior learning and transfer opportunities for students in manufacturing at the college level. We know we're providing navigators for student success support, and we want to build stronger partnerships with workforce. So that's kind of the overview of what we said our project is, and hopefully you all had a chance to read the statement of work before you got on the line today. But I want you to consider for each of these, and really please talk, because if you don't, this is going to be quite a dull meeting. I want you to each tell us your expectations and your vision for the CHAMP project around each of the following. So I'm going to throw out one at a time those kind of brief overview things, and then to really have you all talk to each other, because there's some places where the statement of work is potentially unclear or our direction is potentially unclear, and this leadership team really is the group that will define what that scope looks like as we move forward for the next 3 years. So the first thing on the list is alignment with other Colorado initiatives in manufacturing. I know we have a number of people who, this is why they're on the phone. We got House Bill 1165 this last, legislative session, and we know that John and his group are working on manufacturing career pathways. We have the Colorado First, an existing grant program. We have the sector partnerships. We have a number of different organizations doing work around advanced manufacturing. And so I really want to hear from you all about how you envision the CHAMP project to align with these other projects. Tim, will you get us started?
Oh, I'm the lucky one, huh? Sure. I think I was just waiting in silence, wondering if you were going to have to do that, and then you picked me. We've had a lot of discussions, in case you've been part of this, as we did the 1165 kickoff luncheon on Tuesday. I'll just give you my vision for the combination of the two, because the reality is the CHAMP proposal and 1165 are hand in glove. 1165 gives us the legislative possibilities, the ability to create the career pathway. CHAMP gives us the ability to build the programs that will make that pathway a reality. So the vision that I've shared and people have heard me say is, this has got to be it's a highway. It's a highway with on and off ramps, so that employees, or whether it's youth coming out of high school and going into Chris's programs down in Denver or Red Rocks or wherever, but they can go in and they can start working on a career, starting with career and technical training, go in and work the workforce for a while, get off the highway, go get a job, and then maybe come back then a few years later and go get a community college degree or a four-year degree. The same thing holds true. We have to have on and off ramps for men and women, say, returning from the military or, you know, redefining their career later in life. The whole idea is that we have programs available to provide on and off ramps for the workforce. But those on and off ramps have to feed into programs that meet the current and future needs of manufacturers. We can't be training for training's sake. It has to be meeting the needs of the manufacturers. Sorry, now you're sorry you asked me first.
No, I'm happy I asked you first.
This is John Vukic, and I would just echo what Tim just shared with you all, and I think we have a tremendous opportunity in Colorado right now with these two initiatives to move it forward, to move them forward together under one umbrella, all of the intent of serving, you know, the manufacturing community and, of course, connecting students, adult learners, veterans, and so forth to manufacturers for, you know, great job opportunities and great job growth options for them. So I think that's right on target.
This is Paul Harder. I have a comment.
Please.
As a manufacturer, taking a look at this slide, you know, if this was a meeting talking about how you heat the hydraulic system on a garbage truck at 3 o'clock in the morning when it's 20 below zero, I could go on and on. But I look at this slide, and this is almost overwhelming to me as a manufacturer. I understand the importance overall, but I wonder where I plug in, and I suspect that a number of my peers feel the same, and I believe if you were to present this slide to the manufacturing sector partnership we have up here in northern Colorado, folks would quickly glaze over with the acronyms and the House bill language, et cetera, wondering, okay, well, how does this affect me? Where do I plug in? So I think the most critical word on this slide is alignment. As we go out and talk to the manufacturers and try to drag them out of their day-to-day, sometimes violently tactical world, is to present a unified front when we ask those questions of them about the skills that they need and hopefully even their downstream involvement in helping develop materials and present materials in a learning environment. We need to do that in a way that shows some real unity to those folks. They don't feel like they're getting tapped on the shoulder for different surveys by different groups, and they can't remember the last people they talked to, et cetera. So, my comment is that word alignment is going to be really important when we reach out to manufacturers.
Great point.
Can you hear me?
Gina, go ahead.
What I see with this, from a manufacturing point of view, I think our manufacturing group down in southern Colorado does a fairly good job of keeping the manufacturers up to date on the different grants and stuff that are available out in there. In fact, they actually come and knock on our door saying, hey, we got some funding, let's help you with your training. And one thing that we see down in southern Colorado is we got a lot of heavy industry down here. But again, and I had this discussion in my executive team meeting earlier this week, is it's amazing how high the unemployment rate is when you can't find qualified people out in the market today. And I think we're taking the approach in southern Colorado of trying to hit the earlier grades with regards to middle school and high school, trying to make us look glamorous in manufacturing again. But from an employer standpoint, I mean, I hired 15 people this year, and it took me over almost a full year to find hourly employees. And I'm talking, my guys make about $50,000 a year starting wages. And I can't find those people out there, and it would be nice to be able to go to the school and say, hey, you know what, I need an electrician, or I need a millwright, or I need this person, and I know that they've had, they're kind of like an engineer. You know, when you go to Colorado School of Mines, you know you're going to get an engineer. They've had internships, they've had, you know, field sessions, they've had stuff that are going to make them successful on the job, and I don't know if you've got that in the hourly rate. And that would be really nice to design in the community college system where we could go out and start attracting more people that way. And myself, I've put a lot of pressure on Steve to help with the Workforce Center to help us try to find qualified candidates. And so I think this is going to be a great mechanism to get us what we need and maybe help bring the unemployment down. But we got to start making manufacturing more appealing to this younger generation.
This is Emily, and Stephanie is with me as well, and we just really wanted to echo, Paul, thank you for your comments earlier, and just to kind of alert you all that the regional sector partnership, that's why we feel that approach, and that's why we've worked really closely with CHAMP and 1165 to ensure that there is one industry engagement process across both 1165 and CHAMP, and that we aren't knocking on businesses' doors too many times and overwhelming them. So, Paul, thank you. I just wanted to thank you also for stepping up and really leading the Northern Colorado Partnership. Those efforts are also budding across the state. There are already efforts going on in Pueblo and in different areas. Those of you in regions where you don't have sector partnerships yet, we'll be working with you to create the sector partnership and the unified approach for working with businesses.
And to clarify, getting rid of the government language, when we say sector partnership, we mean a regional partnership led by a specific industry. So in this case, a manufacturing industry partnership that's led by industry but has all of the public partners at the table working together to address these solutions. And then each of those regional partnerships feed up to the statewide key industry network that then will work with CAMA, who is the champion of that, work with them and the CAMT, which is our manufacturing extension partnership, and work with all of those statewide partners to make sure that information that's gathered at the regional level feeds up not only to 1165 and CHAMPS, but to all efforts around manufacturing in the state. And that's really the key, because you can't do the whole state at once. The regional partnerships, that regional engagement has to be critical.
Noah, do you have anything you want to add?
Yeah, this is Noah here. I just stepped in a little late. Carla got whisked away as a surprise for her birthday to Mexico this morning, so I'm filling in here. But no, I mean, I came in when Tim was making his points, and I guess I agree with all the sentiments about alignment and everything, and I'm just interested in getting into the rest of the agenda of talking about what that means and what are our next steps and what is this group's role in ensuring that. So
thanks. So I'll take Noah's cue as a good intro to keep moving. I don't know, Paul, if you like this particular icon any better, but just another way of saying we've got a lot of different people working around creating a pipeline of talent for Colorado, and lots of folks doing work that should really feed into helping people get the skills that they need so that you do have people who you could employ. And so Gina can say, it didn't take me 6 months to hire someone who can make a really good wage in my industry. It's just that they have to have some skills. So the first thing, and maybe one of the really central things that we're doing in this CHAMP project, is creating curriculum. So each of our colleges has said we have one or many areas in manufacturing that we're going to focus on. And to create content or deliver content, to buy lots of equipment so that we update our machining programs, so that our welding programs really are delivering the content that you're saying in industry that you need us to be developing and delivering to people so that you can hire them. So one of the things we know is a requirement of our project is that we put things in what's called open content. So it doesn't mean that it has to be an online class, although that certainly would be maybe the gold standard. But all of the content that we develop has to be put out on the Internet so that it's free to the world. We're using federal dollars to pay for the content, and so it essentially means that we put the content out there on the Internet so anyone could see it. So then in workforce, you could say, gosh, you don't have to go to Front Range. You don't have to go to CCD to read the material that they created. You can read it. and decide if that is going to be a class that you do want to sign up for. And you could see right away, here's where I would go and actually do training material, and here's what it is that I would be working through. So all of our content has to be online. So one of the things I want to know from you all is how you want us to do that. We can deliver courses online. We can deliver them as hybrid courses. So that's where part of the content's online and part of the content is face-to-face in a more traditional classroom, or F2F is the face-to-face, what you probably envision as a much more traditional classroom setting. In other grants, we've seen kind of an alternative delivery emphasis, so where we do many more nights and weekends kinds of programs. And the last part of this, where we know we have questions, is around content modularization. So what that means is that traditionally in a course, let's say we have a 3-credit intro to welding class, and that is pretty fairly standard. And so most of you probably have a vision of what that looks like. But one of the things we've heard from workforce over and over is we have people who come in and they understand and could easily master the first third of that class. So it's not enough content to say you're going to be waved out of the class, but it's enough content that they know the first third. And so is there a way to modularize our content in these high-tech programs so that the person can come in just for the pieces they need? And so we really want to hear from you all, how do you want us to do this, and what is your vision for the products that we actually create when we're finished?
Casey, this is Stephanie. One of the things that really resonated with me at the lunch launch Tuesday, was the points that the manufacturers made about the need for both classroom and applied learning, and the ability to be able to partner with some of the manufacturers. So as people are, it works great for incumbent worker training. If somebody is already working at a business and they go and they get these additional skills, that's great because they could take them back to work every day and apply them. But what about somebody who is a new student that doesn't have a job yet? Is there some way we can set up some combination internship, apprenticeship part of it where we're partnering with the manufacturers and getting them both the actual hands-on applied learning as well as that learning in the classroom and in the labs that you guys will be building out with this grant? But, you know, that's one thing I would like to see is a much closer partnership with the manufacturers to get people some real-life work experience while they're still taking the classes.
Stephanie, thanks for bringing that up, because that was actually, I just didn't know where I'd bring that up in the agenda, but I think that's the other message I took away from Tuesday quite clearly is how do we build more apprenticeship programs, and they need to be tailored. So, I mean, we know we have the great EverEZ program down in Pueblo, and that's a great model, but it may not necessarily fit into the Longmont or the Fort Collins region. So the question that I have is not knowing the nitty-gritty details of the whole CHAMP proposal, is there an ability to build some apprenticeship programs into the CHAMP proposal?
Absolutely.
Casey, this is Steve Track. Can I have something real quick?
Steve, I know that's you, but you're a little fuzzy.
You can't even see my face, and you know I'm fuzzy. Anyway, a couple of quick things about modularization, and I think it goes back, obviously, to the employer input. If they say they're looking at skills for a specific focused occupation. Like, I know PCC is talking about in their welding program modifying kind of the traditional way to look at modules on one type of welding, like focus on MIG, FERT, and do, you know, everything that it would take to get somebody ready for one skill level. You know, a particular company may only want new people or different types. So I think that's one important thing in terms of, you know, putting it in modules. And then I want to just echo what Tim said. And this is something I really think we need to start early and keep repeating with the manufacturing company. What we need from them in terms of buy-in is not just input into programs and curriculum, but agreements to that they'll utilize internships, that they'll look at people, interview, or even some type of pre-training agreement or hire. That's been a weakness that I've seen in some of our other grant programs. You know, all of the manufacturing companies are incumbent worker training, and I understand that. But if we can get people trained on the skills that the companies are asking for, then we need those workplace-based opportunities.
And so, Steve, is your vision that the project directors from each college reach out to the manufacturers who said, yes, we support this, and from right away start putting students in internship kinds of programs at those sites?
Yes, and it also goes back to utilizing existing organizations and stuff. I would highly recommend that the existing sector partnerships or sector partnerships that are getting up and running, we use those as much as possible as a sounding board, to provide input in terms of advisory groups. So we're getting the net out as broad as possible in terms of input from manufacturing. And right away, whether it be the project director or, one of the staff people, I know in Fogo the workforce center is going to have some role in that, talking to the companies right away about their willingness to commit to internships, pre-hire agreements, et cetera, et cetera.
Steve, this is Tim, and I agree with what you're saying, but the one issue I think we're going to have to, and this popped up in the lunch on Tuesday, I could generate a lot of interest with businesses on apprenticeships, but they'll run from it when they look to the administrative side of it. So one of the things I think we need to resolve first, and this is what was discussed when Steve, or John, you brought up the Maricopa model, but how do we build into the CHAMP proposal an administrative model for somebody to administer these apprenticeships? Because otherwise, businesses are going to run from them given the amount of paperwork. So John brought up the model of Maricopa Community College acting as the administrator for it. I know in New York, the MEP administers apprenticeship programs. So I think we need to make sure we have a clear definition of what will be required of these manufacturers. They all are willing to say, yeah, we'll do an apprenticeship, but what's it going to cost me? And I do think we need to first define that so that we can be very clear to them what's going to be asked of them.
Yeah, and on that, Tim, this is Noah here. What are we meaning by apprenticeship? I mean, we're tossing around apprenticeship, we're tossing around internship, we're tossing around applied learning. The EVRAS model in Pueblo, as far as I know, I mean, that's like a 1 to 2 year, pretty intense, full-time, more traditional apprenticeship program, which does seem like there are a lot of hurdles to that. And I guess just looking at the list that's on the slide, something that's coming to mind that I'll just throw out there and see if it makes sense, but is there sort of a advanced hybrid version here where there can be sort of a three-part learning approach where there might be some online content, there might be some, classroom time at the community college, and then the applied time at actual manufacturing companies, and maybe it's by module, and company A says there'll be an on-site applied learning site, between these hours for these four modules, and company B says for those seven modules, and I don't know if there's any precedent for that kind of thing, but getting the manufacturers involved as the actual learning locations. And maybe then there's an opportunity for sort of umbrella agreements, but they're sort of they're a learning location for XYZ modules, and maybe that can simplify some of the paperwork. I don't know if there's any precedent for that, but I'm just trying to blend all this together.
Yeah, no, I like that idea as well. This is Tricia with Emily Griffith. We do a lot of apprenticeship partnerships with union and non-union contractors, and I think that I heard someone speak earlier about the importance of introducing people who are not familiar with what manufacturing is to this trade and to this industry, and getting them out there as almost an introductory method, but it would be really important for them to see that it's different than what maybe they are envisioning about manufacturing, and it could be really good in terms of just introducing people to this field.
Yeah, this is Paul Harder again. To build on that comment, I really like the concept of learning sites, and I think taken far enough, that could address a concern that I have, in that not all manufacturing sites are created equal. I've had the opportunity to tour a number of them throughout my career and learn from some. I come out of them oftentimes saying there's two wows. There's the wow when you're excited, and there's the wow when you wish you'd have gone someplace else. I toured a manufacturing site here in Colorado, a well-known Colorado manufacturer that's been very successful. I toured their site just a couple of weeks ago. And I have to tell you, they're, in my estimation, their success is primarily built on their marketing and name recognition. What I saw in their plant definitely wasn't anything that I would have considered modern manufacturing technique. And I think if you, I almost feel like you would want some kind of a vetting process, and that's why I like the idea of creating learning sites, because then I'm assuming that in that model there would be some look at, okay, well, what does this particular manufacturer have to offer that's truly cutting edge, that truly does tie in with this concept of a learning environment and a place where they're going to learn modern techniques. So I really like that concept, and I think that helps bridge across where we've run into some important semantical issues between what's an apprentice and what's an intern, joint learning, et cetera. I think you start by identifying these sites and what they have to offer.
Hey, Noel, this is John Lucas. Let me just throw something else in there just real quick. With regards to, like, apprenticeship programs, we talked about this briefly at the meeting on Tuesday, but back to Tim's reference to Maricopa Community College down in the Phoenix area, one of the things that they're doing is, there are several states in the country that are doing this now, where there are organizations, and several of the states are actually using community college systems as the organizing entities that are really taking care of the administrative aspects of apprenticeship programs, particularly for smaller organizations that, you know, becomes administratively very intense in terms of, you know, tracking hours and attendance and so on and so forth. So that is one of the things that we can certainly look at. We've already actually talked with the folks at Maricopa about what they're doing and their process and so forth, and they've been very helpful up to this point. I'm sure if we wanted to dig into that further, they'd be very open to those discussions. So just know that that's an option, that if we want to look at that, we could certainly pursue it.
Real quick, a term that I've heard that I think fits well is called workplace-based training, and it covers apprenticeships, internship, on-the-job training, anything where or all of the training is focused on the job. So
everybody who has answered my question on this has said we really want workplace-based training, we really want students out working in partnership with our employers. Sounds like modules, probably a thumbs up, a good idea, different kinds of learning modalities and formats so that students could access content potentially online and also face-to-face, but more important than a face-to-face classroom, face-to-face with an employer. Some of the folks who are on the line or in the room from colleges, I've heard you tell me that that's not what you prefer to do for a number of reasons, and I think this might be a good place for you to speak to that, because where I'm going with this, based on what you're all telling me, is I'm going to start telling our colleges that the expectation is online delivery, not face-to-face classroom environments, but face-to-face employer environments, and really getting out there to form those relationships so that we have students on job sites doing training. So if that's not what you want from your college, could you speak up about what your vision really looks like?
This is Sunny, and I think that that might be just too black and white, and that we have opportunities to use simulation at the college, and not just online, because I still think we need maybe a three-part process where some modules are done face-to-face, some can be done through simulation, which is cheaper than internship or partnership, and then if we do want a significant workplace-based training program, I agree that there's a significant amount of administrative costs involved with that, and I think that the community colleges may be interested in helping with that, but we would need resources. I mean, we already do some of it, but if we wanted to really increase it significantly, then you need a coordinator. You need somebody who's going to place the students, work with the employers, monitor their progress, make sure that they have the soft skills necessary, and if not, you know, how are they doing out there? One of the first things that is a concern for me with internships or partnerships, or even if you want to call it workplace-based learning, is that we are very careful on who we place, and that they are going to represent the college well, that they are going to be the type of employee or intern that the manufacturer wants, and that we are partnering in solving problems when it's not going the way it should. So because we really want to maintain a very high level relationship with our employers in the community, and it is really, really important that we do that.
This is Kelly with Red Rock. Can you hear me okay?
Yeah, go ahead, Kelly.
Okay, well, I piggyback on that. With our high school enrollment, I think our focus is slightly different. While we would love to do a lot of online, really, I think ours is going to be more of a face-to-face with a lot of simulation built into our actually videotaping capabilities so that they can work on their soft skills, so to speak, their workplace skills in the actual environment of, you know, working on a project, this thing comes up, how do you deal with it, and then building those skills. So I see ours as more of a hands-on face-to-face, certainly open to maybe a hybrid format and encouraging them to take ownership and empowering the students to take ownership in their education. But ours is definitely going to be more of a face-to-face kind of thing. That's our vision. Right?
This is Chris Budden with CCD. We see the need for internships as a very important aspect of preparing our students to be able to go to the workplace, but the basic and even intermediate and some of the advanced activities need to be face-to-face because they have to actually be working on the equipment in preparation for going out on those internships. So I think it's a case of how much expertise or what level of expertise does a person need to have to be able to do an internship, and what kind of intern does an individual company need, and we're going to have to work that as an individual situation. So our internship coordinators are going to have to find out what does ABC need and what does XYZ need, and then try to find a student that meets that requirement. But I have to echo what was said, I think, by Gina, and that is that we want to make sure that whoever's going out there is well prepared and is going to represent the college well. We expect all of our folks to do that, but there are going to be a certain number of students that aren't the best student and may not do well in the career field even when they complete the program, and of course a number of them don't complete the program. So, well, that's part of our concern. Now, part of what we're going to do in our preparation during this grant is make some of our courses where they can do programming as a hybrid activity, but when it comes time to get on the wire EDM system or get on the five-axis machine, they're going to have to come to the shop to do those things because they can't learn the machine without actually touching it. And I don't know how we can do that in an industry without affecting their production activities. And if we can do that, that's great, but we have to consider that production is their real purpose, and the internship is something that allows them to find employees that helps that production move forward. So there's a fine line there, I think, that we need to work with if we're talking about doing on-site training of some kind.
Stacy, you were nodding your head when Chris was talking. What part?
Yeah, I think that I want to create a physical environment for the students to develop the skill to make them employable, it will fail.
Right.
So you can either create a mobile system like Mr. Vukic did down in Pueblo, you can partner with machine shops, but if you interrupt their regular business or you cost them money, that's why we don't have internships now.
Right.
So yes, in the long run, it creates a workforce, but in the short run, there's no way you can prepare a person to be a CNC operator entry level unless they have a lot of hours operating a CNC.
Right.
Unless they understand, unless their math skills are such that they have shop math with algebra, geometry, and trigonometry. If they know how to measure, there's a very specific set of skills that cannot be taught in a classroom. They have to be taught in that environment that they will then be working in.
Right.
And just, I apologize because I'm late, but I am curious, are we talking at all about using some of the national resources that are available just off the shelf?
We haven't, but...
There's National Tool and Machining Association has a nationally recognized apprenticeship program. It is a four-year program. There are many machine shops using it for the same reasons that we're talking about. The SME, Society of Manufacturing Engineers, has a four-year program that is a combination of applied competencies and college coursework, and it results in the CT, John, you know what it is, right? CT, FG, TE, or whatever. It's a technical certification for manufacturing, but I think instead of trying to start from scratch, it would make a lot of sense to use that available national approved competency vocabulary and modulars to build into the delivery system in Colorado.
So this is Noah, just trying to follow along everything here, but so it sounds like there are modules within those that could be adapted, because I don't think anyone on this call is interested in creating more four-year programs. This seems to be about shifting the model a bit.
If you look at the site called Tooling U, which is owned by the Society of Manufacturing Engineers, it also has some scholarship money, you'll see a variety of choices that people can, you can customize it, you can make it strictly CNC machine, you can make it a brick press operation, and I think they have a total of 400 and some courses.
Cool. And then back on the comments that Chris was making, and I think I heard correct that part of the concern about having students be in the industry environment is that they won't sort of get along in the industry environment, and that reflects poorly on the institution, and I get that, but it's also like, seems like a fail early type situation. It's like if someone's not really meant for this career and it's not going to work, might as well figure that out earlier rather than go through full training so they're the best CNC operator, but they'll never, you know, be able to apply it if they can't get along. And I don't know how we address that because, yeah, the community college training universe is not my universe, but it does seem like if there's an opportunity to expose those deficiencies earlier rather than later, so at least they can be worked on or someone can decide it's not the path for them, seems like a reasonable way to approach it. I don't know.
No, I have two responses on that. One is if you pre-math test people, if they can't get the math, they're not going to succeed. So you can narrow the candidates down strictly on that. In terms of soft skills, I don't know how many of you have machinist friends, but the soft skill requirement as a machinist is much lower than, say, an HR person, because you're standing at a machine making metal parts. So not that you don't have to have some skills, but you're not writing presentations, you're not part of a communications team. It's, the position itself does not have as high a requirement on soft skills as perhaps other careers.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, Linda.
This is Linda Murphy with CUA, and I think that screening, that pre-screening, that exposure to the industry, we've got in Colorado, we've got lots of examples of how we're doing that. For example, in the healthcare industry, They don't like blood. They shouldn't go into health care. And before we started with this pre-screening, it was amazing how many people didn't know this, that it would be, could be yucky at times or could be standing on their feet all day. So I think with our sector partnerships, there really is, there are models also in other states, Pennsylvania, Texas, Arizona, where they've got different screening tools that they that they can use with people who might be interested in enrolling in manufacturing training. I agree with you, there's still going to be some people that bomb out, but I think it would reduce it, and I think we definitely could do something, and it already exists. We don't need to recreate it.
So I think my synopsis on this is going to be that I'll push the colleges. Certainly we know everything they develop has to be put online, but it doesn't sound like the online course delivery is necessarily an important thing, but to look at nationally normed curriculum, and as the curriculum teams are looking to develop things to really work with things that are recognized in products and services that are recognized in the industry, but to modularize content as much as possible so that we can have some flexible delivery for students, and to really keep a focus around getting students into workplaces. We'll call them in, we'll go with internship programs for now, because we do know that the apprenticeships are a different animal altogether. There's some legal definitions around what apprenticeship means different from what we're really seem to be talking about. And recognizing, to Sunny's point, that we have resources in this project to be able to facilitate that on the college side, to have navigators and project directors working with our businesses in our region and with our workforce centers in our region to say, okay, we do have these five modules. Where is a site where we could do some of this potentially, and think about some of that kind of alternative delivery. So if you feel strong that that's a terrible synopsis, let me know. But that's certainly the direction that we'll point the colleges in. Linda?
Casey, in terms of the communication loop and repository for information, where, like some of the links and websites that were mentioned with national certification, workforce is aware of many models in other states that might be helpful. Who do we send those to? Who could be the collector of information? In Kua region, we have about six different colleges, so I don't want to have to send them to all of them. Who could we send those to that would look at them and distribute them as appropriate?
Are you talking about curriculum in particular?
Might be curriculum. It might be many different things.
So
that would be
many
helpful.
Different things. Feel free to send anything you want to me.
Okay.
I'm probably not actually the right person, but I'll give it to whoever it is.
Okay.
Yeah.
That's great. Thanks.
Yeah.
Casey, this is Paul Harder. I have a comment, but I may withhold it depending on how you answer my question that I have, because I don't want to bog us down at this point. But my question is, at some point, are you going to talk about scope of content to be developed, or is that a different meeting?
So that's a great question, Paul. This group, we're really having focused on what's your vision for the project overall, and then we have a different group made up of faculty members, industry reps, and project leads from each college who will really get into the weeds around, okay, we're talking about a welding program. What exactly should be in the welding program, and what's that content look like, and how are we going to do it? And I am teaching this module, and someone else is doing this one, and let's fight about whether or not we're both on the same page or if that's important.
Okay, because from an overall scope standpoint, and as a board member for the Colorado Advanced Manufacturing Alliance, I really have to caution this thought that soft skills aren't important and that we're going to teach people how to plug numbers into a five-axis machine or run a good weld bead. There are a number of skills that employee needed a modern manufacturing environment in order to be successful and in order to make that manufacturer successful. I walked into a meeting here the other day where I've got a master's degree in industrial engineer leading three welders in a discussion using Ishikawa techniques to do root cause analysis on weld porosity. This is not blue-collar, dirty, dumb, broken fingernails type work, folks. The scope is much bigger than that.
I have to second that as well. When we bring in people here for the facility, we do a skills assessment, which is the hard skills with regards to math and reading and comprehension and reviewing diagrams. But at the same time, we put them through an assessment where we judge them on teamwork and how they resolve issues amongst each other, how they actually handle if they were to supervise. Because, again, my facility runs on natural work teams. Eventually, the supervisors are like, when you're on a flat organization and you're trying to make quick decisions, you look for your workforce to do that for you. And I guess just coming back to what I'd like to see is, again, the skills, the math and that type of stuff should be done in the classroom and stuff. I'm not looking for a master type guy to come start working for me. We'll do the master training. What you guys need to make sure is the fundamentals are there for us and that the people have got the good work ethic, because there's a whole bunch of people out there that could be smart and have the skills but they don't work as well. So how do you find those people that have the skills that you guys provide them and then plus have the work ethic that when they come to industry, we can take them from the level you guys give us on to the next level. We have to find that base level where you're going to give them all to us.
Thank you both, Gina and Paul. I see all the college folks in the room taking copious notes as you're talking.
Casey, this is John Bukic again. And Paul and Chris, maybe to your point, one of the things that we've used in Southern Colorado, and in fact we're going to end up using it as the foundation for the manufacturing career pathway work, is the model of competencies that was developed by the U.S. Department of Labor and specifically for manufacturing. And in that, it's got kind of a pyramid structure, and the lower three tiers of that pyramid structure, as it kind of breaks it down into skill sets and competencies, the lower three tiers of that really look to address the same kind of things that you're talking about, Chris and Paul, and that is, you know, the ability to communicate, work in a team environment, you know, showing up to work on time, et cetera. And, you know, it's something, if you haven't seen that particular model, it might be something at least to scan over. So, Casey, I'll be happy to send you the link to that, if that's of value to send out. I'm sorry?
Somebody just held it up. Somebody in the room has a flyer with the pyramid on it.
Great. Okay, so you have
the content that we make sure we get out to the advisory as they start building, because I think your point is well made that there are some foundational skills that we want to make sure are included in all of our programs, that it's not just about can you weld this piece of metal to this piece of metal, that there are other skills that are really important for us to make sure are part of our curriculum. And luckily, this group doesn't have to dig into that right now, so I'm going to move us along.
Casey, I would just like to add one thing. This is Stephanie, and I guess not add. I want to make sure I understand correctly. And so I understand that we're the leadership team, and as the leadership team, you really want us to be at the higher, more strategic level in how things are done and applied. And then your advisory board is the board that we'll really dig into the details and the weeds and all of that. And you've got a mix of educators and workforce people and manufacturers on that advisory board. But am I correct that additionally, we're really using those sector partnerships in each one of the regions as the place to garner a lot of information from a lot of manufacturers in that specific region
to help inform that the community colleges in that region and then inform up to the advisory board that's developing the overall curriculum to, or the, not the curriculum itself, but getting into all of those details, where a broader amount of manufacturers can have input on the specific knowledge, skills, and abilities that they need in their region for the things that they're having the hardest time getting employees for. Is that correct?
Synopsis, Stephanie. I think I'll just do a little voice clip of what you just said and project that out to everybody. Yes, that's correct.
Thank you.
Okay, so the next thing on our list to walk through and to ask you all what your vision for this is around something that's called a prior learning assessment. So one of the things we know we can do is change or update prior learning policy at the system level. So one of the nice things about having the community college system is that, for example, all 13 community colleges in Colorado have similar policies around things. So we all know that we have policy right now around prior learning. We also know that it's not being used in a uniform way across those 13 community colleges. So one thing we know we can use this grant to do is to leverage how that prior learning assessment is used on each of our campuses. And then we have the amazing opportunity to be able to bridge that partnership with Emily Griffith, Ames, and Metro because they're part of the grant project. So it can also mean how do we articulate credit potentially that people learn through prior or earn through prior learning with other institutions. So what that means kind of on the ground is if you have a person who's been a welder for 20 years and they never got a degree and now they're at a point where it would be really advantageous for them to have that welding degree, what are the things that we can do to have them demonstrate what they've learned, earn credit for what they've earned, so that then we can actually award them the degree that they have those knowledge and skills around. It's not like we're just giving them credit for fun. But to have you all talk about what would your ideal vision for that be? What do we do? What do we put together? Do you have thoughts around prior learning in particular and how that would help your employees or help your students?
Casey, this is Steve Turner. Can I ask a quick question first?
Yeah.
I've heard a couple of different definitions and positions about credit for prior learning. And is there a difference between credit for prior learning and credit for prior experience? Because I am sure, talking to a lot of the companies, that they're interested in both. You know, giving credit for maybe a classroom or a credit or non-credit course that an employee took, but also the potential to give employees credit for their on-the-job. So a student that maybe has, you know, 6, 8, 10, whatever years of inference reading or some introductory level skill doesn't have to take that. Are we talking in CHAMP about both, about prior learning and prior experience?
So those are two different things, and let me tell you what the difference is, and maybe that'll help. We don't do credit for prior experience. Just showing me your resume and saying, I was a welder for 10 years, isn't going to be enough to get you credit in any of our colleges. What you actually earn credit for is what you learned from being a welder. And so what we ask students to document is what they learned. So we would sit them down with our welding competencies, and then they would demonstrate, probably in welding, that they know how to do each of those things. So if it's really important that you understand an arc weld and that there's no beading and that the weld is smooth, then you're going to demonstrate that. And it's not that you had 10 years of welding experience, but that you learned how to do these welds during your experience. So what you're documenting is what your actual learning is, and that's what colleges give credit for. It's for learning, not for actual experience.
I said that's exactly the answer that I'm hoping to get.
Okay. Thanks for asking the question.
I have an additional
question. Yeah. Stacey has a question.
So if a person has a certification from the National Welding Society, would that be recognized?
So her question was, if there's a certification from the National Welding Society, is that recognized for credit? And that would probably be something that we use in the portfolio to demonstrate what they've learned. So they would say, here's what I know how to do that got me the certificate in the first place.
and then that for us would be part of the documentation around here's what I know how to do.
Excuse me, I'm sorry, Casey. Finish.
Yeah, go ahead, Sam.
I think isn't this an intersection between 1165 and what you guys are doing with CHAMP? Because, I mean, to Stacy's point, that should be a stackable certificate that does carry value into the educational system. If you got an AWS-certified welder, I mean, I can, having had AWS-certified welders, that's a good certificate to carry forward. I would hope that as we move forward with this with 1165, we can have that certificate carry more value than just, you know, some work experience on a resume.
So it's a great certificate to carry forward, Tim, and it shouldn't just be a point on your resume, but we need to turn it into credit if it's going to count towards part of an associate's degree. So, yes, I mean, it could very well be the first 4 credits in a welding associate's degree, but we have to turn it into credit on some of these transcripts so that we can actually issue them that welding degree. And so part of what BITSE will actually be working on with a group of people who we solicit who say this is something I'm really interested in and want to volunteer on is what does that portfolio look like? If we have that AWS certificate right away, do we just say, yeah, you for sure get 4 credits, and then we move on? Or how is that evaluated? And we can have a really standard, this is what it looks like for Colorado that comes out of the project if that's what you say we should do. Yeah.
This is Dipsy. Just to put in there, too, something to know about this. There's actually quite a lot of national certifications and nationally recognized certifications. The American Council on Education has created a number of crosswalk 2 credits. So a lot of this isn't about whether the college agrees that it's worth something. It can be, if as we choose to create it, it can be that there are certain things that have been vetted nationally as well that say this is worth X amount of credit. And then the colleges then would need to look at that and align it to their own programs. That's another reason why it's not just immediately applicable, but it needs to be, the colleges need to see that it actually fits the requirements of the program to some extent. So in that sense, it's stackable as it's appropriate. You know, so you wouldn't get a welding certificate as a stackable certificate to a generalized advanced manufacturing program unless the welding was part of the program. So similar to that, but and that's why it's a portfolio process. So it's a compilation of information that then is examined for its alignment to a program. But I think that the thing about this that's great is that you talk about these things and it's exactly what the model nationally looks like and what we're hoping to build for the state.
And this is Chris. On this topic that Tim's bringing up, say, for instance, an AWS certification, an SMAW, we have students take 4 classes before they generally have the skill set to be able to pass that SMAW certification with AWS. So if somebody comes in with that certificate, we see that as meeting the requirements of those 4 courses, with the exception of maybe the blueprint reading that's involved in those courses. So there's a little bit of extra that we would have to look at to make a determination if the person actually had the skills of completing those 4 courses. What at this point, we don't really have a mechanism to turn those into credits without doing it as a test out. If we do it as a test out, then the person still has to pay a certain amount to be able to have those credits from those 4 courses applied to their transcript, which of course then applied to a certificate or degree. So we have somewhat a mechanism at this point to be able to do that, but it hasn't been fine-tuned the way it should be. I think by the time we finish this CHAMP grant, we will have that in place for a number of these national certifications.
And this is Stephanie. To me, that would be one of the most valuable outcomes possible from this, is to really take the combination of the prior learning assessments, all of these nationally recognized credentials, and build out that true career pathway where a person can step in at any point in their life and be assessed and say, okay, related to this 2-year degree or whatever it is that you need to get, here on the continuum, here's where you're at. You're somewhere between step one and step 25, but we're not going to make you start at step one if you really should be at step 10. And to be able to have that mapped out in a way where every college is willing, or each, at least the colleges in the grant, are willing to accept that, yes, that's real and it matches what's happening nationally, that's huge. And that would set this grant and Colorado and the manufacturing industry in Colorado ahead of the rest of the country by so much if we could actually accomplish that as an outcome of this grant.
This prior learning assessment, to echo what Stephanie just said, is potentially the place where Colorado will get the most national recognition for our work in this grant. Other states are interested in our curriculum and will be interested in things that we do that support us, so internships and relationships that we're building and processes that we're creating. But to really be able to do what Stephanie's saying around, gosh, we took this NIMS certification and we all know that that's the first four classes for this particular associate's degree program, and let's move somebody along so they can complete their associates more quickly. That really is a pretty significant impact. Certainly what the vision is around the pathway, but not particularly well applied universally yet.
And the other thing I would add to that is a huge benefit to the employers, and what we heard through the key industry networks is employers want employees who have an opportunity to go to school, get a job, get some experience, go back to school. So when we're talking about those stackable credentials, being able to do that, you know, learn what you need to know and then go apply it in work, whether it's through an internship or getting a job, and then going back and adding to it, what the employers have told us is that that's what's going to make the best possible employee, somebody that is mixing work experience with their education. And if by having that mapped out pathway to where you get credit for those things, I just think that that's going to help the employers identify the best possible people. And it's also going to encourage employer investment in their employees to go back and get these additional trainings if they know that they're actually going to lead to something that's of value to the business itself.
So I'm going to move to our next slide because they're related. And the next slide is around transfer and articulation. And I think the spin-off of that credit for prior learning, how do we then stack this towards a four-year degree? So we have a great opportunity here with Metro as one of our partners, and that they've said, yeah, they want to articulate from our community college manufacturing programs to the engineering program that's going on at Metro, and to really come up with some more seamless transfer and articulation from the two-year to the four-year mission. So continuing along that stackable mindset that you get a certificate, you get the associate's degree, and then you go on and get a four-year degree in engineering, gives people more flexibility in terms of their career trajectory for sure. But we also want to come up with other statewide agreements as folks are interested. So if Colorado School of Mines says, we're jealous and Metro did this and we want to do it too, we would be happy to do that kind of similar articulation agreement in other places. So certainly to keep that in mind, and want to ask you all, you know, what's your vision there and who should we be approaching? And we know Regis is a great partner with Credit for Prior Learning, so do we make sure and do that partnership with Regis even though they're not in the grant? What's your thought on that?
Hey, Casey, before you go on to that, in the prior learning, we did talk about vets, and hopefully that'll be covered. Everybody wants some vet prior learning involved in this whole process as well.
Some what, Bruce? Oh, veteran. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. There's an entire veterans track to all of this. We're very, very specifically focused on military experience, on the specific needs of vets in terms of building portfolios that are pulling from different sources around the world and around the country, and, you know, very specific to their job descriptions. There's actually an entire track of the whole PLA process that will specifically address that.
Illinois has a good model, statewide model. Mm-hmm. That they just have it for prior learning for veterans specifically in manufacturing.
In case anyone on the phone couldn't hear that, Bitsy said there is a whole specific track around prior learning assessment for veterans in the project and in the grants. And then Linda said that Illinois just passed some legislation.
Right.
Illinois just passed some legislation that really, in particular, supports veterans and their prior learning. Other thoughts, directions, marching orders around transfer and prior learning credit?
Yeah, this is Sunny.
I sat on the original team that developed the articulation, statewide articulation agreement for engineering, which is now pretty much been decided ineffectual. And because the only thing that we could agree on statewide was some math and some basic science requirements. And so I think the direction that we're going to go in the future is building articulation agreements with our universities and colleges in our regional and local areas. And not to say that we shouldn't build one with MSU with regard to this, because they would be a terrific partner. But I think we do need to allow for and plan for other statewide agreements with our partners that we are currently working with.
Stacey, were you going to say something?
I think you have to build out the community college piece of it before you can then jump to the four-year piece of it. Because CU Denver and Boulder and TCB, and School of Mines, engineering is a pretty big topic. So, but if you build out the first level and then make it work with Metro, then it can grow.
And we know our colleges, we're putting them on a timeline to have their content developed for spring of 2015. So that gives us a year that they can work in these sector partnerships, work with the advisory group, really get in the weeds and develop out the content, and then starting in spring of 2015, start actually delivering the courses to students. So it gives us some time this first year of the grant to create exactly what Stacey's saying, and then we are planning that later on in the grant period that really is the right time to then approach potential other partners and say, okay, could this be the first three classes in your whatever sequence? And I know the engineering faculty at Metro have already really started thinking about that and saying, we're looking at these courses and what the competencies say they are, even without sitting in on the course or looking at the content. We know here's where they align, and so here's where our questions, and that's the very same conversation.
And there, I believe, there's an existing agreement between Red Rocks and School of Mines. I don't know if other community colleges have that for years. Bridge has been built in some areas.
Yes. Anything else from phone callers about transfer, articulation, credit for prior learning? So the next thing on our list is around workforce center relationships, and the direction we want to get from you all now is around how to build relationships between the colleges and the workforce centers, strategies for the strongest partnerships, and potential training opportunities that we can leverage as we start down this path and start with our project. Emily, will you get us started with some of your thinking in this area?
Actually, Emily had to step out, so this is Stephanie. And I think that both Dave and Linda are here, and so I'm probably going to defer to them. But what I wanted to start out with is, again, I think that, you know, with the relationship that we have built around the manufacturing industry through the sector partnerships where workforce, education, and economic development are all there at that table, I think it's going to be really important to bring in the leadership from the college's advisory boards that are related to this type of curriculum and have that conversation at that level with the manufacturers. But then it's really critical that the workforce centers and the community colleges in each one of the regions build off of the current relationships that they have or use this as an opportunity to strengthen relationships. And we're willing to help in any way we can. But as the council, you know, we're really that convener of economic development, workforce, and education. So the specific relationships, that's why Emily asked Linda on behalf of the urban workforce regions and Dave on behalf of the rural workforce regions. And then I know Steve Chorak is on here, too, and there may be some other workforce region people. So with that, I'll defer to them because that's really their area of expertise, not so much ours.
Sonny, I just want to echo that because I see the workforce centers as the linchpins that connect community colleges with their business partners, manufacturers, and they have so much expertise and knowledge that, and I know I've talked to Steve about this, that it's just really, really important for them to help us do that work.
This is Dave Griffin with the Rural Consortium, and you guys in Pueblo are very fortunate in that you have a great model. And I know it's taken years to build, but I think how to build the relationships or continue our relationships is, is really just identifying the really good partnerships that exist today and then share those across the board. And I think some of the strategies or the characteristics of the strong partnerships that exist today, both in, you know, in the urban regions and the rural regions, are there's very clearly defined roles of each of the partners that, you know, we were talking earlier about alignment and who does what, is really having a clear understanding of, okay, this is the workforce systems role, this is the industry and business role, this is the community college or educational system role, and then economic development role in the whole picture. Those make the best partnerships. So it's just expanding that and making sharing the great practices.
Of course, I agree with everything that Stephanie and Dave said. This is Linda Murphy with the Urban Partnership. The thing that I'd like to add and what we would definitely be doing, because we've been so successful with a couple of different sector partnerships, it is absolutely industry. It's the business that leads this. It's not community colleges, it's not workforce, it's not even economic development. It's got to be the business. And what we do is we don't get the room and talk to business, like we're doing a lot of talking, and we don't use the acronyms, like we're up there and Paul was saying, where do I fit in? We convene business, and we listen. And then what we do is leave and scramble to figure out how do we give them what it is they said they needed. I would love to see, having worked for community college system for, I think, 7 years at the state level a number of years ago, I'm very familiar with the CTE Advisory Council. I'm also very familiar with the student organizations. Statewide, I would love to see us connect those groups with other sector partnerships led by business so that they're all around the table either talking if they're business or listening if they're non-business, if they're government. And then what we can do is convene other meetings for people like us to talk in acronyms, things like that. I would definitely want us to use existing partnerships. That'd be great if we can use the other industry organizations, but I'd like them also not to do all the talking, but really listen to what business has to say. What was the question? I know I made great points, but what was the question?
On this project, what's your vision?
I think I just told you my vision. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. I think certainly for college folks on the line, Pueblo is maybe our best model to look at. So if you're feeling like I don't know what to do, how do I do this, or what is it supposed to look like? That's a place to certainly go and visit and say, what are you doing? I wouldn't say you need to clone that, but for some of us who like having models and like having examples, that might be a good example. Are there others that you guys...
I think there are other... I think it'd be great if community colleges could take a look at the sector partnerships, because I think those are slightly different, and we can certainly make that connection if they'd like to listen and learn. I think that there are other models.
And so for everybody to know, Stephanie's office will actually be facilitating sector partnerships in each of the regions where we have grant projects going on. And we'll tell all of our grantees that the expectation is for them to go and attend the sector partnerships and to listen to what businesses are saying there so that they can do exactly what Linda said and go back and say, okay, they told us to do this, and now we have to figure out how to do this.
I'd like to just make a comment about convening business. And I do think it's really, really important, and we really need a full understanding about what they need. But we also need to be respectful about the time commitment and the responsibilities that senior business folks have to running their businesses. And I don't think it's realistic to have the expectation that they're going to drop their billion-dollar business opportunities or running their businesses to run the meetings constantly. So I think we need to be very careful of how often and when and how we convene business. And we need to really have our ducks in a row when we do that so that we don't waste even a second of their time. I agree, we don't often talk the same language, but one of the things that we need to be respectful of is they're in the business of making money and they've got to keep their production going and they have many or more concerns that we have as managers or supervisors. And so, you know, when we do convene them, we need to be really, really on target with what we're doing so that they see it's important to be there. They're going to get a lot of information or sharing opportunity with us and go away from that experience feeling like it was really worthwhile.
Thanks, Jenny. Go ahead, Linda.
Obviously, if the person who was on the phone, Sunny, is very familiar with sector partnerships. She absolutely described the key points in engaging employers. One of the things I'd like to add, or two other things, don't ask them the same thing you've already asked them a million times when you convene them. They've given us so much information. Don't start from scratch. And secondly, if you ask them something, and they give you the information, we all need to be ready to turn around and show them that we're doing it, that we heard. We can't take a year and a half, we can't take 2 years, we can't ignore it. So often we ask them for what their needs are, and then they don't see any evidence that we've addressed them. So I think those are the two things. Don't keep asking them the same questions. And once you ask them, pick the low-hanging fruit and be prepared to show them results right away so that they know we're not only asking, we're listening, we're responding.
Stephanie, I know the one in Buffalo is planned. Do you have others yet?
Yes, Paul is actually one of the leaders for the one up in Northern Colorado, and I know that Lynn is working on helping coordinate when that meeting is going to be exactly. And so each of the sector partnerships are modeled after the national model. Colorado really is a national model for convening and managing these industry partnerships in a way that's effective and utilizes the business's time in the most positive way possible. And so that's what we're working at doing. In some places like Pueblo, they've been doing it for years and years and years, and we'll just keep building off of what they already have. Northern Colorado just launched this summer, actually before we knew about the grants and the legislation for sure, but it's perfect timing for them. There's many, many efforts in the Metro Denver area that Linda and others are working to convene together in a more collaborative way. But there's, so each, the, even though each different sector partnership is at a different level of their evolution, we're working very intently with them to make sure that they have everything that they need to be in the place they need to be to inform everything that the colleges need to be able to be successful in the grant in a timely way and to follow that pattern that Linda was talking about, that template that Linda was talking about that has been proven over many years nationally to work and to do it the right way so that the businesses feel like they're time is used in the most possible way and that something real is actually coming out of it.
Go ahead.
This is John Bukic. Just real quick, one of the things I wanted to share with everybody is that through the 1165, the Manufacturing Career Pathway Development process, in terms of employer engagement, one of the things that we're doing, we'll be working through the existing and new sector partnerships around the state to host what we're calling micro summits, which are essentially information gathering sessions that really kind of dig down into some of the skill sets and competency needs that manufacturers currently have. And the thing I just want to share with you about that is that, you know, there's been surveys and there's been things done around the state, to the same end, but there really has not been an entire, at least that we're aware of, there hasn't been an entire process that's actually occurred, you know, across all of the various sector partnerships and pretty much across the entire state. So one of the things that will shake out of this is hopefully that we'll be able to ask the same kind of questions that will support 1165 efforts as well as CHAMP efforts, and be able to share that information. So exactly, you know, to Linda Murphy's point, that we're not going out and asking folks, in the next month or two questions, and then someone else comes out and asks the very same questions, you know, a week or two later, kind of unbeknownst to the first group. So we really, it does call for coordination between projects and how we do this so that we do minimize the amount of downtime for, you know, the manufacturer. So I just wanted to share that. The first micro summit is planned for Pueblo January 24th, and there are five others planned around the state, and those dates are yet to be determined, but we'll make sure that we get those to you for distribution.
Yeah, this is Paul. I wanted to make a comment about the Northern Colorado sector. The particular initiative that I'm championing is the one in networking. And what we're really trying to do there is mobilize and engage the manufacturers. Certainly the point's been made that these folks have jobs that pull them away and other things that compete for their time and their attention, that there's a cost involved in them being engaged in these projects. But we want to underscore with them that this isn't really a cost, this is a future investment. We want to mobilize them, we want to engage them. We're going to explore with them at some upcoming meetings what the topics are that get them excited. And I think a real key piece of information, certainly for me, it turned on a light bulb in our last networking subcommittee meeting, was we can engage these manufacturers at various levels of their organizations. We don't have to pull in just the HR director or the vice president of operations or even the president or CEO of the company. We can engage them in a way that's more diagonally through the organization and cross-functionally through the organization. For example, if the topic at hand is engineering graphics, in most cases, you probably don't want the principal there. You want folks that are actively engaged in that. So we want to create these other opportunities for the manufacturers to share resources and time. That's going to be a big focus of our upcoming networking subcommittee meeting, and then we're going to reconvene the entire sector partnership on December 19th and get updates from all the subcommittees.
Thank you, Paul. I'm going to give everybody a five-minute break, and then we'll come back and wrap up the rest of the agenda. But we're going to take five, and then plan on being back at, well, I have right now that it's 10:44, we'll call it. So we'll come back at 10:50. Okay, so we're back. I hope you're all back on the phone.
That happened the other day. I woke up.
The next thing we're going to talk
about. I don't
know
if maybe we're not making sure, like it latches so well now that we need to make sure we do.
The next thing we're going to go through is Navigator.
But I'm sure it was my love.
One of the things we have on the grant to help support all the work that we're doing is that all of the colleges have a navigator. And so the idea around the navigator is that it's a person who will design and facilitate a student success course, that they're collaborating with the local workforce center, that they're actually helping students with their prior learning.
Well, I sure appreciate your feedback.
And that they're providing direct services.
Thank you, sir.
And so again, want to go back to everybody on the line and everybody in the room and hear from you. What's your vision for Navigators? And what do you hope they do at the college that you're working with or that you're being served with?
Based on what we've talked about today, something about interfacing with industry, I would assume, would be under there.
That's a good point.
Which is not on the list currently. Interfacing with industry or being sort of that sort of liaison.
Bruce Agati, you've had a really successful navigator on a prior grant, a career coach on a round one CAP grant. Do you want to talk about your expectations for people in that role?
Well, this is Bruce. We are having this person work a lot with the students, probably be working a lot with businesses, like was just mentioned, kind of developing internships is the way we see it. But I think it's important that you find somebody with a good, we're wanting this to be more of a sales and marketing type position as well. So, you know, kind of molding somebody in the right, with the right skills to work with students and be able to work with industry. I don't know if that helps any.
The most successful one we've seen in the past and why I called on Bruce is because they hired a person who came from the Larimer County Workforce Center, and it was somebody who really understood workforce. So you saw in that person somebody who could talk to students and immediately say, here's how you fill this out. Here's what the expectations are. If you're also on some kind of assistance through workforce, here's how we can best support you. And really acted as a pretty amazing conduit between the two.
What industry was that?
Energy.
Because it would also be good if that person could speak with industry. I mean, would have that connection with being able to speak to business. And there are people within the Workforce Center, and maybe in the community college too, who deal with both job seekers and businesses. So that would be good if they were going to hire away anybody else from Workforce. It'd be good to look at their business development unit.
Well, and Cassie, maybe it's already too late for this, but this is Stephanie. When I looked at this, each one of the eight colleges that is participating in the grant would have one career navigator, right? Is that the model, the way it was written in the grant?
Yes.
Okay. So, but to me, a lot of what is the work that the career navigator would do is some combination between what's done by the career counselors at the college and by the business development team and the career coaches at the workforce centers. And so I guess I'm just wondering if there's some way to use that position, whether it's as hiring a person that's kind of that liaison between the community college and the workforce center's business development team, or if there's actually a way to contract with the Workforce Center for a certain portion of that work and give them a specific liaison to work with at the community college. But I love the concept of the career navigators, but what I always hate about it is that as soon as the grant goes away, the position goes away, and you lose all of that expertise and that great system that you built. And so I've just been struggling with, is there some way to do it a little bit different where we could build long-term capacity and relationship between the community college and the workforce center and build off of that work, you know, that's already being done. The workforce centers have great business development teams that have those relationships with industries and work with the sector partnerships. And then the community colleges have these amazing career coaches and guidance counselors. Is there some way to be a little bit innovative about bringing those better together better? And I don't know what the answer is. I just like to see it be more sustainable beyond just funding a position during the time of the grant.
Well, and that's what we are trying to do here at Ames, is kind of morph what the grant says that this navigator should be and make it more fit for our purposes, and be that liaison between Workforce Center, the student, career services, and business. That person's going to have, you know, several different roles there. And what made our career coach, you know, very successful under the round one grant was that the college decided to institutionalize that position right from the get-go. And that's what we're hoping that this position would be as well.
Casey, this is Steve Track. Let me add a slightly different view. What public community colleges have been doing is, contract with the Westport Center to provide...
I can't hear you.
Okay, how about now?
Better.
Can you hear me? What Pueblo Community College is going to do with our Workforce Center is contract through the grant to provide some of the employer engagement piece, convening, development of intern opportunities, and other opportunities, which I think is a natural relationship. Now, I'll preface all of this by saying I think the partnership between the workforce system and the community college system is A, critical, and B, just a very natural relationship. So P6C is going to work with us on, or we're going to provide some of the employer engagement piece. Really, I see the Navigator not so much working in business, but doing exactly what the title talks about in terms of navigating students or potential students through the system, as well as probably even the more important one, working with the Workforce Center staff in recruitment. I see that as a piece that maybe has not been done quite as well in the past, working directly with the workforce system to recruit TA-eligible veterans and whatever other eligible adults mean, but that's the role I see in the Navigator, not so much the business engagement piece.
And I think, Steve, my guess is that your vision is going to be a little bit different maybe from Bruce's, because I know Sublo's right in a specific role for workforce in their portion of the grant. And so the relationship there just even structurally looks different.
Well, that's fine. You know, we can work it out differently in different areas.
Did you say it could be different in different regions?
Yes, definitely.
The only caution I would throw out to that, Steve, would be current capacity of the workforce business reps. Is, are they currently, you know, doing everything they possibly can within a 10-hour day already? That's the only caution I would have.
No, but the same issue, Dave, is going to come back to, is a Navigator going to be able to help with recruiting, help with the community college navigation system, and do business engagement? I think that's probably a little beyond the scope of one person. So I guess my real answer is engage all of the possible resources. If workforce centers have dedicated business staff, work through them on the employer engagement piece, and then have the Navigator, or if you want to reverse the role, that would work also. And I think it's going to be one size is not going to fit all.
This is Linda. I agree with you, Steve. I think the details need to be worked out by the group who's working on this, not this group. But one of the things they need to consider is that, I don't know what percentage, but I think it's relatively small percentage of students referred to these programs will actually be coming through the Workforce Center, and the Workforce Center can definitely share leads and sites that they develop with businesses with the program. Their priority is going to be seeing Workforce Center clients get in those sites, but there's going to have to be a lot more employer engagement for the other students. So we're going to need to coordinate that, and maybe it isn't through Navigators. I don't know. Maybe it's through some of the groups listed or some of the people, employers participating on 1165 or whatever. It won't just be workforce that's going to be engaging employers. We just need to coordinate it, so we don't all try to engage one employer on the same day and have six or seven people contact you. So it's got to be coordinated.
I agree with that, Linda. I just think we need to work on our, build on our existing relationships. And when you've got business services staff that have got relationships with manufacturing companies, what I don't think would be the best idea is then bring someone up and try to go out and try to reestablish a role. You get my point.
Yeah, I agree with Steve.
Anything from any of the colleges around navigators and questions you have or thoughts that you have about people who you bring on in this role? I think Stephanie's point also is a really good one that all keep in mind around sustainability and thinking right now around how do we, what are the strategies going to be for in 3 years when the position isn't funded anymore? How do we maintain these relationships? And I don't know that we'll have that answer today, but I'll certainly continue to put it on agendas around just sustainability in general, and to keep thinking about it, that this is an amazing amount of funding and a great opportunity, but it's not forever. So to think about how we can keep it going.
This is Chris Budden with Community College of Denver. Our approach to this is that the navigator is more like what we had at one time called a case manager, and we work more with students no matter where they come from as they come into the system and help them work their way through the college system, because though we may think it's efficient, it's not necessarily efficient to those who don't understand what they have to do to be able to get into a college and be able to go through the processes. And then the other position that we have is going to be the grant manager / the person that's going to handle the internships. And so we see it once they get into the classes and they start going through the programs, they'll start working with that internship coordinator who will be out in the community making those connections. So we see it as two positions really needing to do this. There's so much work needs to be done to get the students into school and keep them going academically. I just don't see how one person can make all of that happen. So,
and I think in a place as big as CCD, one person can't.
Yeah, that just can't be done, I don't think.
That's a good point Chris brings up. If they have another person developing internships, then the internship, that means meeting with business, then the internship person should be coordinating with business services. It's not just the navigator. But we can work that out internally somehow. Chris can work it out.
Anything else anyone on the line wants to say about navigators? So the next step on our list is around outcomes. What we've got up on the screen is the current line, so the line on the top that says current, is each school who's a partner on the grant and the number of students who they said they would serve on the project, so that's within our original statement of work. After we went through how the schools arrived at their numbers, we found out that we probably want a modification, and we don't want to go for any modifications without the group saying this makes sense to us. So underneath are the proposed outcome numbers. So what the colleges did was they looked at what they said, knowing that we'd start counting students being served in classes starting that spring of 2015, so taking the first year to do content develop, and then start enrolling students in our new coursework for that spring of 2015. And then working forward to count how many individual people does that mean get served in the project over time. And so we saw a couple places where there's some changes, just based off of really being a little more critical about those projections, but wanted to for sure make you all aware of it, because something we'll be continuously doing in this group is looking at what we're reporting to the department about the grant and where we are in terms of what's been developed, what's been delivered, who are we serving, and then to see really, do you have questions? Do you have a bigger vision around how we're counting people?
Can you, to start, Casey, could you explain what you mean by outcomes? Or is it just enrolling in a program? Is it certificates? Is it placement? Is it jobs?
So that,
and to define a program.
Okay. So in terms of the numbers that you see up on your screen, it's individual students served by the grant. And the way we count them as served by the grant is that they're in a course that we say is redesigned. So it could just be a single course. So it could be introduction to welding. And the course could be part of a certificate program that might be a short, hey, this, here's a two-course certificate program. It could be part of a much longer certificate program, an eight-course certificate program, and it could be part of a full associate's degree still at the course level. So we count students who are in the courses, and all that's tied back to our content because we know one of the things that we have to deliver at the end of this is the meat of each individual course. So we have to put that back at the beginning. We talked about that open educational resource. We have to put the content all online in this certain format so anyone can access it. So we do that all at the course level and we help students enroll at the course level. So that's how we know who serves. From the navigator's perspective, they serve anybody who is in these courses. And so then when we get to the program level, each school has defined their own program. So it might just be a certificate. Like Front Range said, their whole focus around the project is going to be the NIMS certificate program. So part of the courses in the NIMS certificate would eventually build to an associate's degree, but they aren't focusing on the entire associate's degree. They're focusing on the NIMS portion. Where Chris at CCD has eight different areas of focus, so a number of certificates up to and including an associate's degree. So we know we're going to get a lot more content out of this group. And then it's numbers of students enrolled in courses, and we can't duplicate the headcount. So if we've got a student enrolled in intro to welding and then they enroll in advanced welding, we count them once. And so that's how we then arrive at in terms of number of students served. Does that also answer the program question, Dave?
Yeah. Thank
and
you.
Then beyond that, we end up with many more outcomes that we also will have to hit based on these students. So of Ames's 202 students they're going to serve, a portion of them then have a goal around, of the 202, we think this many will be incumbent workers, we think this many will be unemployed people, so then they have subcategories around who gets employed, how much do they make after they're employed, but the big target that we start with is how many people even are you going to serve to start with.
Casey, quick question. Of the 202 under Ames, those are not having to be served by the navigator necessarily, right?
Nope.
Okay. Just wanted to clarify.
Some of them will be the students who your navigator is serving.
Yes, absolutely. But these are going to be actual students in seats of the classes and programs that we identified.
And what's the time frame?
They have till the end of the grant. So that is all the way through September 30th, 2017 is the last day we count.
And it doesn't start until spring of
2015.
What if the community college has courses available prior to January of 15.
Then we'll count them.
Then you do count
then
them?
Then we count them.
Oh.
We're just, we gave them an artificial internal timeline that they have to be up and ready by spring of 2015. But they can't drag their feet longer than that.
So if CCD has a welding course now,
they
can
won't count
them?
Anything for this current fall, the semester we're in, because nothing that's happening this fall is impacted by the grant. So they haven't developed any curriculum, they haven't changed anything, they've purchased no equipment, they've done nothing with those students, they're not getting any extra support services from a navigator, they did no credit for prior learning assessment on any of them. So we'll use them as baseline students to be able to make comparisons, and we'll want to make comparisons from students who used to be in welding to students who do something with the grant and are we doing something better. So we'll make some, we'll certainly do some of those, and I'll give you guys the data for it as soon as we start running them. But starting in spring, if Chris has equipment in place and they do start changing their curriculum so that it is new,
than those Ruby students that we would capture from CCD.
So it's only new.
Yeah.
Okay. So like Larimer County and Sheen, it wouldn't be any of their numbers?
Nothing right now, because they haven't done anything with the grant. But if George is amazing and over Christmas break completely changes his content and updates all the stuff to mirror the new equipment that they're planning on getting, then spring will be
okay. Right now. Good.
I would guess our best case scenario would be students right now next fall. But this spring seems way too optimistic, knowing that equipment hasn't been approved from DOL yet and probably won't get approved until we think February. And then there's some lead time on it actually arriving. Okay. Thank you.
And this is Chris again. We're looking at some of our courses that are going to be revised from face-to-face to hybrids being available when you start the academic year in the summer. Because, of course, our academic year starts in the summer. So if we can make that happen, we'll start counting some of those students in both machine and welding as we start the summer semester. But it depends on when those classes are finalized. So.
This is Casey. Is there a representative for Red Rock? They were. They chatted and said they had to get off.
Okay. I was just curious, they have that Healthy Warren Tech program that has a wait list every semester, and I believe Joe Martin's pumping through 40 kids a semester and has a full-blown shop, but their number actually went down.
Their number went down. They seem to think that in the way the terms were structured, that what they get would be...
Ever, is there something that they do for the electricity?
Yeah, I'll send you...
There was a 40 new students every semester, that there was some duplication, and so they wanted to make sure that they were clear on not duplicating what they were offering. So then the question for the group is, what other grant goals do you want to see? So here in the list, you can see what we really have is student search. This is what we've committed to DOL around. But it's certainly helpful to me, and something I've seen in other projects that's nice is to say, okay, each school also has to have a number for students that their navigator visits with. Each school needs a number for students they place in internships, or students who do some kind of work-based learning experience. There's different things, and based on what you said today or what's important to you, this group could definitely set other grant goals for our project. Or you could say, no, I don't want another goal, but definitely up to you in terms of what you want to do all just produce.
Definitely employment statistics.
Okay.
Hiring and
wages.
Okay. So I'm not sure if this fits, but it's a point that I try to raise in these types of conversations, but, and this is Noah here. Potentially, and I don't know if this has to be an express goal exactly, but potentially some sort of entrepreneurial metric or outlet. You know, obviously jobs and wages is great, but I feel like having looked at the history of some of these programs, when there aren't enough people hiring, but there's a lot of people getting these exciting skills, the programs have sometimes gotten a bit of a black eye for not placing everyone because their only metric was that people are getting hired and getting wages. I'm not sure how we would build that in, but if there is some sort of coordination with small business development centers or some of the resources that are out there that, hey, you're now a welder and maybe you can start your own welding shop or machine shop or something or other. And I think it would be unique. I think it fits Colorado's sort of small business community, and I think it also could provide some cover for the grant if we have a lot of people going through these programs more than there are jobs for, but we're also nudging people to sort of possibly create their own opportunities. So I don't know how that fits in this type of grant, but thought I'd throw that out there.
Maybe we could talk about ways to measure that?
Yeah.
And or this group could assign it to somebody else to come up with ways to measure it. I think, like in our state energy sector partnership grant,
that we had, we did develop a rubric. Entrepreneurs, there are ways to do that, but that's a good one. I'd like to see that. My real interest would be in systemic change, you know, really taking a look at were we able to create systemic change in terms of better working with business, maybe have business rate us on the grant, you know, did they see value in participating in the grant? What would they like to change or something? I'd like to see systemic change. That's one. And I could identify some different areas, and then we could further work that out at another meeting.
So, like having businesses rate us on those partnerships? Bigger than that?
I think it's looking at all the different places that we're engaging business and rating the success of that engagement, how effective that time was used. But it's also, are the, and I don't know if we would be able to get good numbers on this actually during the grant, but it would be interesting to track it for a couple of years after the grant for sure, is are the people that are coming out of these programs getting jobs, and are the employers satisfied with them as employees, and are they coming in with the skills that they were expected to have, that, you know, did the changes that were made meet the desires of the businesses that gave us the input on what they needed? And to be able to track that, you know, 6 months, a year, 18 months after the person gets the job, to really hear back from the businesses, did we provide you with the kind of person that you needed? And then also to ask the person, was the job, you know, is the job meeting your goals for a good job, and do you see it as a smart career choice, and did you get out of the program what you needed out of it?
This is Noah here. I think, go ahead.
Thank you. This is Gina. I was just going to say I echo that as well. I think that is a great comment. Also, I just wanted to say as well, how can we make this available? Let's say we go out and we create something that's just fabulous. And how do we make that available to our current employees? Our current employees right now, I've assessed all my new hires and stuff, but I wasn't involved on the current employees in hiring. How do I bring the skill set up in my organization right now to the level that the new hires are coming in? How are you guys going to help me achieve that as a manufacturer?
And so, Gina, the goal or the outcome would be our current workers being served by the project?
I guess, just looking at the current workforce, not if you pretend like my current workforce, let's say I hire, we go through this, 2 or 3 years down the road, I hire a couple of people, and then I look at the skill set the couple of people I have that I just hired compared to my current workforce. How can I get my current workforce engaged without spending a whole bunch of money on my part? Because at the end, it all comes down to money. How do we make that possible? Well, we've already applied for that.
You what?
We've already applied for that. But I'm looking at it, just, hey, you know, is there something else that we can help employers as well with their current staffing and the skill set that they currently have?
Can we use the grant incumbent worker training if it's funded through another source? And I would think, yeah. Whether it be through tuition
reimbursement.
I'm actually on Gina's laptop. I guess the question is, can we utilize grant training? I would think the answer is yes for incumbent workers if the training was funded through tuition reimbursement, Colorado Horse existing, whatever. I think that's one initial question. And I guess my conception would be yes, we think training is going to work.
Okay, I'll come up with some stuff around that.
To add another one, Noah here again, trying to think some way to build in a way, I mean, sustainability is sort of one term, but sort of an opportunity for continuous improvement, and I guess the place in which I'm thinking about this is specifically around the equipment. So obviously a lot of money in the grant is sort of designated to be spent on equipment. I think there could be a number of layers of goals here, one of which would be to never be paying the ticket price for any equipment, but potentially to be creating partnerships with the equipment manufacturers, that there could be some trade-out upgrade process, you know, a 10-year agreement to always get the newest piece of equipment when they come out with it, so they can, you know, be a designated tester for the new whatever, some way to leverage. I mean, if we're spending millions of dollars investing in equipment, I feel like there should be an opportunity to leverage that to create some sort of agreement where we're not just stuck with that piece of agreement equipment we buy today, but there is some way to build in some opportunity to get that upgraded. I know that there's examples, the Edison Welding Institute, which is more of a R&D type institute based in Columbus. I mean, I think they pay at max 20% of ticket price for any piece of equipment, and a lot of it is just donated straight up because different companies want their equipment to be tested, want it to be in the field, want people to see it. So I think some way of looking at how we look at the bulk purchasing of equipment and how we build relationships with equipment manufacturers so that this isn't just a one-time sunk investment, but we're leveraging it so that we can update equipment beyond just the one-time purchase. So.
One final thing I'd like to say, aren't you glad you...
No,
but when we do the summit, whatever John called those...
Micro summit?
Yeah, micro summit. I think it would be great if we asked business. We've got 1165, we've got the CHAMP grant, we've got career pathways. What would business define as a success of all these efforts? What would say to them as business and taxpayers that these efforts were worth it? I think it'd be great if we made sure we understood what they thought of as a success and that we would include that in the measurement, and that we've got to make sure if they say that, we give them the results.
Stephanie and John, can you do that?
They can do that.
Yep.
Thank you.
John, I
like it. Casey, this is Steve Chart. One last point. I know Rutgers, or at least I'm assuming, think that Rutgers is going to be involved in the evaluation process. And in some of the work that they did for sectors, there was always the struggle to identify return on investment. So maybe getting Rutgers involved early on in terms of goals and outcomes and, you know, ways to measure those may also be a good idea.
I think that's an excellent idea. We contracted with Rutgers to do a complete analysis of the original 12 sector partnerships, and the case studies were great and the information was great, but I wish they would have known at the very beginning what we were going to be asking them for, because trying to create it afterwards was really difficult. And so I agree with Steve completely.
I think they have a much better idea now, Stephanie, having done that analysis, that they come to this project with some pre-existing knowledge around what our sector partnership history is and what our state history is. And they have, you're right, they do have some pretty good ideas about how to leverage some of that prior knowledge.
But we have to ask for it. Better shut it down, Casey.
I want to make sure they feel like they have the opportunity. Anybody else on the call feel like, gosh, it'd be nice if we had a goal around? Okay. So the next thing on our list is our upcoming meeting. Went ahead and scheduled them to the end of the grant, so you know exactly what everything is. The first year, we've got them once a quarter, so it's just after our quarterly report to do. It'll be an opportunity to tell you where we are, what we're doing, where the groups are in terms of development, to demonstrate some of what's going on for you so that you can really get a sense of what's being created on the project, and all along for you to tell us if we're doing something wrong and to change direction, because this first year is going to be really key in terms of setting marching orders for the rest of the grant, and so that's why we're meeting once a quarter. So, and keep in mind that you're seeing something and you're like, this isn't working the way I want it to keep working, please speak up. That's what you're on this group for. And then starting for December 2015, 16, and 17, those are right after our annual reports are due, so you'll be hearing from grant staff, you'll be hearing from project staff at each of the colleges, and from Rutgers around what the evaluation looks like, where we are, we'll do new status updates and into grant updates just around here's what's happening on the project, and want to make sure that you all really are our accountability group and our group to say, yeah, we need you to change direction, and no, we don't need you to change direction. So all these next ones, you can set them on your calendar, and we'll have them all at Metro. They have a space in their student success building called the Cavia. And what the Cavia is cool for is it's like this giant surround sound theater. And so if you need to call in from, say, Lamar, we'll actually project their picture up on the screen so it'll feel like they're in the room. Any questions?
Thanks.
Yeah, thanks, Noah. So that's all I have for you today. I'll stick around if you have any questions, comments, concerns, and if you're not the kind of person who likes to talk after the meeting, please feel free to call yourself.
Thanks, Casey.
Thanks. Casey, would you mind doing that back one slide so we can get those dates on our calendars? Thank you.
Can we get a copy of the slides, or are
yeah.
they available? We talked about a couple of meetings ago.
So we recorded the whole webinar. We'll stop the recording. Brenda will edit it for us so that we miss our break and all of the times they say, and then we'll go up exactly on the CHAMP website.
It's www.cccs.edu. Right. And so do all the leadership teams know what the CHAMP website?
I'll send it to everybody with minutes because
okay.
not everyone is on today.
Yeah,
just
I didn't.
To make sure that everyone feels like, oh, I can go with it.
Thank you, Casey.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Casey.